Hi everyone, this is Sanjana from MOCAT. And now that we are filling the CAT form and other exam forms, there could be doubts in your mind, especially if you're filling it for the first time. So what I'm doing in this video is addressing the most common doubts which our students have asked, and hopefully that helps you as well. Now, two important resources that you should look at is, most important, the CAT 2024 registration guide. Here you pretty much have a step-by-step guide of what you need to do. So make sure that you go through it. It's long, but it'll pretty much address all your questions and it'll also stop you from making mistakes. Let me give you an example. Now, your name should be the same as in your 10th certificate or your 10th mark sheet. This, if you miss and you give a wrong name, this could be, you know, a surname coming first, or say, you know, Vignesh S instead of Vignesh Srinivasan, if I use Vignesh as an example, that could lead to issues later. So please make sure that you go through it in detail. You can also look at my video for CAT form filling. It's a CAT 2023 form, but the only thing that has changed is the addition of another IIM. So now let's start with some of the common questions. I've already spoken about the name. One thing which sometimes people ask is, does it matter if your present address or communication address and the test city are not the same? The answer to that is no, it doesn't. Quite frankly, even if you're giving, say, your permanent address, your family home or something, and right now you're not even living there, it doesn't matter too much, because these days all of the communication is through SMS and email. So you don't really need anything physically. Back in my day, we used to actually get the physical CAT, the CAT scorecard and carry it to IIMs. That's not something that you need now. So it doesn't matter. One of the most common doubts that students have asked me is, I have a CGPA. How do I convert that to marks? So this will be different based on your board or your university if it's for college. But the majority of times you need to multiply by 9.5. So take CBSE for example. If your 10th or 12th are with CBSE board and you have a CGPA, then you need to multiply it by 9.5. So if you have a GPA of 10, then you're multiplying it by 9.5, which converts to 95%. Reason for this is, typically for any board or university, if you are getting between 91 to 100 marks, it becomes a 10 when it comes to your grade point. So for us to bring it back to somewhere in between 91 to 100, they just go for the average, which is 95. So that is what it becomes. Now, if you have 5 subjects on your mark sheet, you could take this 9.5 and multiply it by 5. And similarly, you're taking 100 as the total and multiplying that by 5. So your marks become 475 out of 500. Now, depending on the number of subjects that you have, you would change this. You can do the same thing for your college marks. So if you have a GPA in college, then in that case, again, you could just look to multiply it by 9.5 and convert. However, please ensure to check for your board or for your university. A lot of times these are either given in the college or the university website, or it would be given in your mark sheet itself. It could be written, tucked in somewhere. When in doubt, a lot of times Google will help you. But make sure to check it, because there would be some states or some universities where you need to multiply with a straight 10. So you don't want to lose out a little bit of marks and potentially pull down your composite score a bit. It's not going to have that much of an effect, but why miss it at all? A bonus doubt which I'll address for you here is, how do you calculate CGPA? Sometimes students have only the SGPA, the semester grade point average, and they don't know how to calculate the cumulative grade point average. So it's just a weighted average. So say in your first semester, you've received a GPA of 8, and that's for 10 subjects or 10 credits. And then in your second semester, if you've received a GPA of 9, but that's for 8 subjects, then it becomes 10 into 8 plus 8 into 9. And then you divide by the total number of credits, which in this case becomes 10 plus 8. So similarly, you can calculate it for as many semesters as you have. And if you are still studying or you've recently graduated and you don't have the marks for your final semester or your final year, it doesn't matter. Just share as much as you have. Typically, the CAT authorities and the IIMs or other B schools, they're fairly supportive of this front. As long as you're not doing something unethical or trying to sort of, you know, show a score which is higher than what you have, it'll not matter if you don't have the marks for one semester or two. You will be expected to submit these to the institute that you are joining as proof that you have definitely passed and you've passed with whatever minimums they have. And that'll be sufficient. Sometimes students also ask me that, I have 6 subjects in my mark sheet, but you know, do I take a best of 5? What do I do? So just go with whatever is given in your mark sheet. Just to, you know, improve your score a little bit. Say, you know, if I wanted to take it from 92.4 to 94 or 95, where the points that I will get in my composite score will largely be the same. It doesn't make sense where, you know, you're trying to explain to them that, hey, I have these 6 subjects, but this is the best of 5 or anything like that. You don't want that sort of headache during your interviews. So just go with whatever is given in your mark sheets. Now, in case your university or your institution is not mentioned, you can simply select others and fill in the details. So don't worry if you can't find it, but definitely look to check. You don't want to miss out. The next question which comes up is, what will count as work experience? What if you have an internship? Or what if you had work which was, you know, in between your 12th and your college, or maybe even during college you were working part-time or full-time? So the CAT authorities are very clear on what is counted. First off, they're only looking at your work experience till 31st of July, right? So even if you're working after that, while of course you can speak about it in the interview and all of that, it's not part of your composite score for the institutes which are calculating composite score. Second and more important, only full-time experience after graduation is considered. So if you are in an internship right now after graduating and your offer letter clearly mentions that it's an internship, or maybe you've worked before, right? Maybe you've even put in 8 to 10 hours, right? It actually counts in terms of time and effort as full-time work. They are not considering that. They're only looking at full-time experience after graduation. So in case if you're a fresher, you're still in college, or maybe you've started your work around June, July, or even August, and you felt that your work experience would count, or maybe, you know, you're working before college and you felt that that would count. Unfortunately, it doesn't, but it doesn't matter, because for most institutes, the most important thing, or even, you know, something which they consider 100% is your CAT score. And usually the weightage for work experience will be anywhere from 5 to 10%, if at all. So don't worry about it. I was a fresher. A lot of our students have had less than 1 year work experience, or they've been freshers, and even though, you know, that has hit their composite score a little bit, they have got through top colleges based on their CAT score and their interview performance, and in no way is it impacting your eligibility for CAT or any other college. Now, in case if you have a break in between, you put in the details. If not, you can put zero or just ignore it. If you're not very sure what industry you should check, you can just use Google. Look at the company that you're working in. For example, you know, your role could be sales, but if it is sales in a tech company, you still go for information technology and not retail, right? A very common question is, what are the programs should I apply for? So first off, before we even look at programs, I would definitely recommend that you apply for all of the IIMs. So even if you're very, very clear that, you know what, I want to get through only ABC or ABCL or whatever institute you have in mind. If you're getting some other institute call and that interview happens first, then that's going to help you. It'll be practical experience. It'll also make you a little calmer during the CAT exam, because it's not like, you know, hey, I've selected only ABC and within ABC I've selected only the PGP or something like that. Speaking of PGP, what I would recommend is go for all of the MBA programs. So if you take IIM Ahmedabad, for example, they have the regular MBA and they also have the FABM, which is the Agribusiness Management. You might not want to get into Agribusiness Management, or you might feel that, you know, maybe they will not shortlist you, maybe you don't have relevant education. For now, it's actually worth it to sort of de-risk a little bit and try out all of the programs that are there. You might not want to go for the PhD program, that's totally understandable, and you might not be eligible for Executive MBA, maybe you don't have the work experience that is required. But the regular MBA programs, you should ideally go for all of them. And when it comes to your interview city, take up your city or something which is closest. So, for example, since there isn't a Chennai, probably I'll choose Bangalore. Sometimes I've seen where students will say, hey, you know what, I want to go to the campus. So, for Ahmedabad, I'll select Ahmedabad. For Bangalore, I'll select Bangalore. For Amritsar, I'll select Amritsar, and so on. But then what happens is, a lot of these interviews, they could be scheduled, you know, right next to each other. You could have 3 interviews in a week, or sometimes, you know, you will have an interview in the morning and one in the evening. Some will be online, but many will be offline. And then what happens is, you know, one, there's a huge cost of, you know, flying to different places, and it's stressful. There could be delays and things like that. So go for whichever city is closest to you if your home city is not there. Now, sometimes my students ask me, what if I'm going for PGP and a PGP BA, will they look at it badly during the interview? So one thing which happens is, after the CAT exam, once your scorecard is out, you know your percentiles and you know what are the calls that you are getting. So at that point, when you're reapplying to the institute, you could potentially say that, you know what, I only want to opt for the PGP program. I don't want the BA. Even if you're going for both of them, whether it is the same interview or different interviews, if you are asked, you can always tell them that, see, I'm really keen to get into an IIM and I didn't want to risk, you know, just going for the PGP, right? Because I'm very, very keen to get into, say, in this case, IIM Bangalore. So I know that I want to prioritize PGP over PGP BA, but I would love to get in anywhere. And then once you've finished your interviews, right, based on whatever calls you get, you can take a call. So say you get IIM Bangalore PGP BA, but you're getting IIM Calcutta PGP, you might go for IIM Calcutta PGP, right? So you can always opt out later or you can definitely explain it to them. In fact, a common question which is asked is, what are all the calls that you have and where do we sort of stand in preference? Now, if you're unsure about how to address this question, or there are other interview questions which you feel you don't have the answer to, or you don't know just what will be asked, then definitely subscribe to the YouTube channel. We already have a few resources for interviews and we'll be coming up with more and more videos once the exams are done. Now, if you want to understand more about these programs, so say if you know you want to understand what is OSCM, what is SM, and you know you qualify for it, you can definitely go into the websites and understand more. You can also head on to mockcat.com and hit our blog section where we have a lot of details about CAT, IIMs, other exams and other issues. And that brings me to the next doubt. A lot of students ask me, okay, so I'm applying for IIMs here. What about the other insurance? So you need to apply for each exam and you need to apply for each insurance. So typically your CAT form will have your IIMs, your ZAC form will have XLRI, but all the other insurance, you've got to go to their website and apply. So, you know, say if you want to apply to FMS or SPGN or MDI, right? Through the CAT form, they will get your CAT scorecard. A lot of times they sign up, but you need to go and tell them that, hey, I'm interested to join your insurance. So you've got to go to their website and apply. And again, you need to just track what are the deadlines and preferably finish it off in advance. There are some B schools which will want you to apply before the CAT exam. Majority of them will be after the CAT exam, say, you know, FMS, IITs and all. But there are institutes which will want you to apply beforehand. So just make sure that, you know, you're checking our blog section and you're also going to the colleges and you are checking that out. Now, when it comes to the test city, your first preference should obviously be your own city and then something closer. So I'm based in Chennai. The closest that I have is Pondicherry. So I will go for that. Now that COVID is more or less done, we don't need to worry about crossing state borders and also just look for places which are close by. And we have had students where they fill the CAT form early on, but they've not got their first or their second preference. So just make sure that, you know, you're taking all of the preferences seriously. See, the way it works from what I understand is, say there are 1,000 people in your city that have registered for the CAT exam, but, you know, the examiners across the three slots, sort of maybe, you know, there are only 500, 600 people who can be fitted. So the remaining folks will get their second, third, fourth preference and so on again, depending on how many additional seats are available there. So say, you know, there are 5,000 people in Chennai and they're able to fit only 4,000 and there's only say 200 seats left in Pondicherry in case if everyone has. So out of those 1,000, they can, you know, fit in 200 who've maybe selected Pondicherry as a second preference and then they look at the third and so on. And unfortunately, it's not a first come first serve. So if you fill the CAT form first, it doesn't mean that, you know, you are getting in there early on. It seems to be a random thing. So be prepared that you could get some other city, and if you're getting some other city, make it a point to reach one day in advance. You don't want to reach in the morning even if you have the afternoon slot. Flights, trains could get delayed, there could be cancellations, and you simply don't want the stress, right? You want to reach in advance, stay with relatives or at a hotel, book it off beforehand itself. Even if you're not visiting the test center a day in advance, make sure you map the route, you get an idea of traffic and reach the CAT center a little bit earlier. Once you fill the form, make sure to review it once and just check that you have actually filled everything correctly. The last thing that you want is to have something wrong. The majority of the information cannot get edited. Sometimes they open up an edit window for things like, you know, photograph, test city, things like that. But just assume that you can't edit it. So make sure that you double check it. Take the help of a friend or a family member if you feel that, you know, you might be making a silly mistake or missing something out. In case if you still have made a mistake after payment, all is not lost. You can register using another mobile number and another email ID, but you are essentially making the payment twice. And like I said, it's just added stress. So just check it once and make sure that it's right. Now, when it comes to making the payment, one issue which people sometimes face, especially if you are doing it, you know, close to the deadline, is that, you know, your money is debited, but over here you'll get a message saying that, you know, the transaction hasn't taken place. Now, in such a case, please don't panic. Things like payment gateways and all are usually very well regulated. You should get the money back in a day or two, so you can just retry it. I would suggest don't wait. In case if a lot of time has gone, say it's been about a week or something and you've not got a refund, you can always call the help desk. They might give you some information, and or you can approach your bank wherever you have your card or, you know, account. So don't worry about it too much. You can just give it a little bit of a gap, say an hour or so, and then retry, especially if these are high traffic times. So that's it for me in this video, and stay tuned and definitely subscribe because I'm going to talk more about how do you actually get to 99 percentile. So check out the series if you haven't yet and register on mockcat.com and sign up if you want to prep with 99.9 plus percentilers. All the best.